So what happens if Nikola's second proposal doesn't actually get passed through? That's actually a question I recently got on a Nikola video from a concerned shareholder who asked a very good question. So in this video, I want to give you guys the lowdown on Nikola's current financial situation. I'm going to look at their balance sheet, and I'm going to look at and react to a video from a bunch of YouTubers who are currently shorting Nikola stock to understand what's their thesis around this company and what are some of their misconceptions about this company that we as Nikola shareholders can set straight. But as usual, guys, before we get into it, make sure to drop me a thumbs up and hit that subscribe button if you haven't already. So the first thing I want to address is, what is Nikola's current liquidity position? Well, if we now look at Nikola's balance sheet for 2021, as you can see, they started off with around $522 million in cash and cash equivalents. But as of the first quarter of 2022, they only have around $385 million in cash and cash equivalents. But obviously, we can't just look at that as a vacuum. We have to look at it in perspective to the balance sheet or the liabilities of the company. So if we scroll down and look at the current debts, as you can see right now, they have around $183 million. So from a current ratio standpoint, which essentially tells us the liquidity that Nikola has for the next 12 months, Nikola is in a pretty good financial standpoint, even with the plain cash they have on the balance sheet. Now, the key thing to keep in mind is that this does not include the $600 million equity line of credit from Tunim Stone Capital or the $200 million investment from Antara Capital that was executed back in May. Because obviously May does not fall in the first quarter. So this is not recorded on this balance sheet that we're looking at here. So that's something we want to keep in mind. But if we now look at the long-term debts of Nikola, as you can see, they only fall at around $28 million, with total liabilities now sitting at around $288 million, which means that with the current standpoint, Nikola is not going bankrupt within the next 12 months, especially if you consider the fact that they have institutional investors sitting at their doorsteps looking to invest in their company, as you've seen with Antara Capital and obviously Tunim Stone. But regardless, now I want to give you guys a reaction take to a very critical video made around Nikola, where a bunch of short traders against the stock have been buying put options on Nikola and betting that this company is going to go down a lot more. Now, you guys already know my take on all this short-term BS. I can guarantee you that I cannot predict where the stock price is going to go within the next 1 month or so. And as a long-term investor, I do not care, because that is all short-term noise. My thesis is going to play out within the next 2 to 3 years. And if in 3 years' time, the share price is not higher than where it is right now, then yes, I will consider myself wrong and I will move on to the next investment. But in the short term, I cannot predict where the stock is going to go. This thing can go to a dollar and I would still buy shares in this company to increase my investment and lower my average cost basis. And the reason why this share authorization has become so controversial is because of the fact that simply the stock is trading at a 52-week low. It just happened to be the fact that this company is trading at 52-week lows as the entire market is crashing. So I don't think that this share authorization is the reason why the stock is going down, as people anticipate some sort of dilution happening within the next 12 months. That dilution is going to be irrelevant if we're out of this bear market, because as we've seen with something like Tesla stock in 2020, dilution doesn't necessarily mean that the stock is going to go down. If the demand for the company and the stock is high, then the authorization of shares or the conversion from authorized to outstanding is going to be good. If you guys remember back in 2020, in September, Tesla issued shares of around $3 billion back here when the stock was at all-time highs. But as you can see, in the long term, that didn't matter. Nobody cared in the long term, and nobody cared in the short term either, because the stock price is going up. So the only reason people are really crying about this authorization right now is because the stock for Nikola is down, and it just happened to be caught up in this massive NASDAQ bear market, which obviously the company cannot control. And all Nikola is doing with this second proposal is preparing itself for when the demand for their equity is going to be high as they go into this revenue realization stage in the second quarter. And as the demand for the equity goes up, they have to be ready for any external investors for issuing shares. Right now, they only have around 33 million new shares they can issue to those people. And if JP Morgan or Morgan Stanley decide tomorrow that they want to increase their focus and investment in revenue startups in the EV sector, then Nikola should be ready with shares to available for them to be issued, unless obviously there is some sort of big change in the market cap or in the issuance of shares against the company. But regardless, it's going to be a good thing that Nikola is prepared. But now let's react to one of the folks that is shorting Nikola stock to understand their thesis against this company and where they have some pretty significant drawbacks in their argument.
Milton's the largest Nikola shareholder, owning 11% of the stock, but he controls 20 through an investment vehicle. He owns about 90 million shares, and 95 million shares voted against the new share issue. What idiot has the 5 million shares voting against it? The only thing I can fathom is someone is long and they cannot read a fiscal report or any financial anything on Nikola for their life. They're literally out of money. The people running the company are saying, we're out of money. We need to do a share offering. Oh, it's just hilarious. So
yeah, that's pretty bleak.
It's not good. So there's two scenarios, all right? Nikola investors, the smart ones, and I get it. If hydrogen works, I would be so happy. It would solve so many problems. I believe in the dream that it could happen. I don't know if they're the ones that do it. However, if the long side has a brain, they will vote to dilute shares, temporarily lowering the share price. This meeting is on June 30th. It's 6:26 right now, all right? Option two, Nikola investors who are long don't have a brain, turn down the share offering, leading to a temporary increase because they're idiots. Among dumb Neanderthals, they can't read a financial breakdown, but also inevitably lead to killing the company and sending Nikola down to an over-the-counter stock. Either way, buy a put option and have it expire in a year. Because A, if they vote to, well, okay, just to be clear, I have two different put options, one expired in a year and one expired on August 19th. But A, if they don't do the share offering, I'm gonna show you how much money they have left, they're done. It's over, they will not last a year, they will be 10 cents a stock.
Okay, so I need to have a rebuttal here. First of all, we need to keep in mind that these two people are trading Nikola stock, not investing, so the perspectives are going to be a little bit different. But to answer the question that this guy just raised, which is that Nikola is going to be bankrupt within the next 12 months if this second proposal doesn't go through, well, as you can see, Nikola has around $958 million in net liquidity as of the end of last year, which does not include the $200 million shares or the $200 million it just got from Antara Capital, which means that Nikola has around $1 billion in liquidity available to fund their operations, which is plenty for 2022. So no, Nikola is not going to go bankrupt in 2022 if they don't do the second proposal, but it will put Nikola in a good position for 2023 for when they need to raise more money to fund their fuel cell operations. And the reality is that any Nikola shareholder should have been able to know that Nikola is going to have to raise money at some point. For those of you Nikola shareholders that are voting against this proposal, I understand. That's fine. But if you're saying that this is a very bad thing, this is something that the management is doing, which is very scummy, you guys are very lost. Because it's pretty clear that Nikola can't dominate the EV trucking market by just raising $900 million. Nikola has to raise more money down the road. That is simply how the startup ecosystem works. Every single company in the past has to raise money. Tesla had to raise billions and billions of dollars over a span of 5 years, which obviously includes diluting their share count and increasing the authorized shares that the company has. They also recently just did an increase in their own authorized shares through a proxy statement because of their new upcoming stock split. And so this argument around Nikola being a bad company just because they're increasing the share authorization is pretty stupid in my opinion, because this kind of offering or money raise could have been seen from a mile away. The only thing we didn't know is that could this money raise come during a time when Nikola's stock is going up or it's going down? And when Nikola's stock is going up, it makes this financial situation a little bit trickier. But it could have also just been going up like it did during these times, and it would have been a little bit easier for Nikola to raise money, and potentially the sentiment around this so-called offering would have been a lot better. But regardless, let's continue on with what this guy has to say.
Because they literally will have all these production facilities, like their nice production facility in Coolidge, that is essentially a giant storage place without they literally can't do anything. But, you know, you either collect your cash in a month or roll out options to a year, collect even more. This is that little Adam Sandler. Yeah. Do you remember Big Daddy?
Yeah.
He's playing the card game? Yeah.
What's his name called? It's called I Win.
I don't want to go too much into this, but this is, I've shown this before. We've done a financial breakdown on them. As of 12/31, they had $497 million left, losing $450 million per year, i.e. they have 1 year worth of money as of December. Mm-hmm. And then, oh wait, we accidentally spent $130 million in one quarter. So now we have $360 million as of March. It's just not a good situation. That $1.2 billion cash they were trying to raise was when the stock price was about $780. It's now $560. So they probably won't even get that much, or they'll have to do a higher share price than they were hoping.
Yeah.
So I think I made my point pretty clear here. All these guys are doing is they're just trying to short the share price in the short term, which again is something that we can control as investors. But he's also spreading a lot of fear and false information around the company, which I think I needed to clear up. But I hope I've made my point very clear in this video. I know Nikola's situation looks dire according to the share price and according to the sentiment, but as you can see, the data shows us that it's not as dire as it looks. Nikola has 12 months of liquidity at minimum, and this share authorization is just a natural part of the startup process, especially in a competitive industry like in the EV space. But as usual, guys, make sure to drop me a thumbs up if you found some value from this video. Let me know down in the comment section below what you guys thought of these people that are shorting Nikola. And what do you think is Nikola's financial position for the next 12 months? And can they actually make this second proposal count? But as usual, guys, make sure to drop me a thumbs up. And I'll catch you guys in the next video. Take care.